All right, you're welcome back. It's still TVC Breakfast and it is talk time. The bombardment of militants in Areko Ogun State and some creeks in Lagos has taken a new dimension with troops beginning ground action against pipeline vandals. Acting Director, Defense Information Brigadier General Rabi Abubakar said soldiers and other security personnel have been deployed to the area to forestall any surprise attacks by the militants.
Now, Abubakar also revealed that some of the vandals fled Areko to Tongeji, an island off the coast of Badagry. He said there are plans to track and prevent them from regrouping. Now we have joining us is the Lagos State Commissioner of Police, Fatayo Osheni. It's good to have you in the studio again today.
Good morning.
Now, we often, when we talk with people generally and they hear some of these reports on the media, and they say, why are the security agencies responding now when this thing has been on ground, it's been happening over the years and all of that. Now, can you make us understand, why does it take so long for this kind of decisive response to put an end to something like a pipeline vandalism when it has been going on over the years?
Operations are carried out as per the expediency. And of course, most of the internal security challenges are supposed to be led by the Nigeria Police Force. When it comes to that head, where military support will be required, the military is called in to support the civil authority. And that is exactly what has happened, that it's got into a dimension where a joint action, a decisive action are required. And that is why at this point in time, government considered it necessary. And as I said, the expediency nature of it, it's become expedient that the military should come and support and work in aid of the police. And that is why that action is taking place now and is still ongoing.
Now, this operation has been described as, or tagged, Operation Awatse, meaning Operation Scatter, am I correct? One gets the impression that, you know, the idea is to just get these militants or pipeline vandals or criminals, as it were, you know, just get them out of those areas. What happens? How do you guarantee that they don't come back?
From your report that is heard, it's indicated there that some of them have been found to have been moving to certain areas. That is why ground troops are deployed. The ground troops are supposed to follow on the air attack and of course trace, locate, cordon, search all the places that are identified to be those places the militants, the criminal elements have run into. And in order to make sure that they don't come and rear their ugly heads again, the ground troops will remain on ground. And the ground troops is also made of the different security forces, the army, the police, the civil defense, including some of the emergency response team. So we continue to look out for them. Indication, apart from Badagry, we've also found out as some of them have found themselves towards Ondo State, one of the riverine areas in Ondo State. As of day before yesterday, there are some that are arrested along Gore Road in the course of them escaping. So we continue to do that, maintain our presence at those locations, because the advantage they've always had is the creek, the swamp, the mangrove forest, which ordinarily cannot be accessed except you row boats. And you see the follow-on that is being done by the two-state government, opening up that creek so that it become navigable, destroying some of the cover they use and destroying some of those things they call camps. So once you are able to get them off that place. They won't have that advantage over the security agents again. And once we remain vigilant on the ground, we believe that they won't come back again. And that is why in some of the interactions I've had as well, it's for them. If you know that there is no place to hide, why don't you go and do another thing? Because the excuse some of them had been given is that, we cannot do vandalism again. We cannot do bunkering again. It's bunkering and vandalism. Are they really?
Is it a crime?
So these are crimes. So that is why we've been saying that let them approach the alternate means the government had produced. What are those alternate means? The government had opened up so many platforms. You can access some of those banks, get soft loan, go and do small trading. You can go on the internet, log in with your certificates. So all these avenues have been opened. Why won't they have a rethink? Because at first, they said there is no work. There was no work, rather. They engaged in criminal activities. You now know that there is no hidden place. That if you are doing it, you'll be caught, you'll be seen. Then go through the alternate means and engage yourself in meaningful livelihood. That is it.
Okay.
All right.
Well, let's give a perspective to our viewers to have a better understanding of this, or what we're talking about. Now, Arepo and Ikorodu are riverine communities sharing boundaries with Ogun in Ogun and Lagos State. Now, Arepo in Ogun State shares boundary with Lagos to the north, and Ikorodu itself, which is in Lagos, shares boundary with Ogun State to the east. Now, sometimes when you pitch them together, they talk about how communal these two areas are. Mm. And with the navigation between them, they're both riverine areas. They have river cutting across both cities, or both little enclaves, as the case may be.
As it were, the lines are actually very blurred. You don't even know when you move from Lagos,
to Ogun State.
Apart from being riverine communities, Arepo and Ikorodu communities inhabit at least 10 million people, most of whom work in Lagos State but live in Ogun. Now, that perhaps is responsible for the usual gridlock on the roads linking the two communities on a daily basis. Apart from harboring a huge population, these two communities also have a network of petroleum pipelines buried underground linking NNPC depots in Lagos.
Now, that perhaps also explains reasons for the intermittent explosions, pipeline vandalism and kidnappings in the two areas, that's Arepo and Ikorodu. Now, unlike Ikorodu, residents of Arepo wake up to thick cloud of dark smoke billowing from burning ruptured NNPC pipelines, and gradually the once quiet community, which was made popular by the creation of a journalist estate in the 1990s, gradually turned to a theater of war.
In Ikorodu, kidnappings, sporadic shootings and pipeline vandalism was the order of the day. Until now, residents live in fear and were not sure if military help could solve the problem. Six landlords were killed in June, two hotels raided, and at least 15 other persons massacred in just one day. Let's come back to the Commissioner of Police who's right here in the studio with us. Yes, it used to be that people did not have confidence. The sense of security was totally lacking in these areas, especially in the Ikorodu end of it. Would you say with this operation right now that you've been able to restore that sense of security that seems to have been lacking? That's one hand. Then is there any kind of profiling of these criminals, as it were, that you're able to tell that these people really are just after people who were engaged in pipeline vandalism to steal fuel and all of that? Because there are reports that these people are actually militants and not necessarily criminals who are just going after the pipelines.
First, let me dispel that assertion that the people in the area had lacked confidence in the security agencies. That is not true. Before this operation, there have been police visibility there. Some of the law-abiding citizens in those areas have been cooperating with the police. Some of the things you get that they've reeled out are actually exaggeration. And when you say that, on a daily basis, the plagiarism, That is not true. Before this operation, there have been police visibility there. Some of the law-abiding citizens in those areas have been cooperating with the police. Some of the things you get that they've reeled out are actually exaggeration. And when you say that, oh yes, on a daily basis, the places, that is not true. We have the statistics. What we need to understand and what will be appealing to members of the public, especially people that live in that area, is that they should not make themselves vulnerable. Some of your reporters, your photojournalists have been in those areas. For God's sake, I mentioned it on one radio station. The Yoruba people have a name they call Folorunsho. And that if you are bearing Folorunsho, you won't say because they've given me to God to protect. And you now take a threat to want to climb a palm tree instead of using a rope. If you are taking yourself right inside the creek where it is not accessible for people to protect you, you've made yourself unprotectable. That is one thing. And why do they do it? Not all of them. Some of the people that live there are also criminal elements, just like you have in border communities. The most people that go into border communities are also smugglers. They are conspirators. They are accomplices. So some of the people that live in that area deliberately put themselves, you know, vulnerable to these fellows. They wear hands in gloves before. Some of them, when those guys coop oil from the pipeline they vandaled, they give them the oil, the product to sell for them. And because now there is no oil to scoop, there is nothing to steal from government again, they look for soft targets. For God's sake, go to some of those places, houses where you probably have to climb a raft before you go in. That is one thing. And that is why we're saying that with all this operation, if the people living in those areas still don't support police efforts, supporting security efforts, to join hands together with us.
But when you talk about supporting police efforts, when, you know, there's a situation where there's absence of police posts or even policemen, you know, for these people to actually approach, to let them know exactly what is going on, especially in areas like Agbede, Igbo, Olomu, and the rest of them. There's almost lack of police presence in those areas.
I disagree with you as well. There is a Wutu police station. Owutu police station covers that place. Ogijo has, that is Ogun State, has a police post that covers that place. It's all these things that you read and you see. It will be necessary for you to go there. And where you don't have a police structure standing, we do extend patrol, motorized patrols to those areas, which they can assess. Oh yes, there are some of the areas, as I said. These are thick mangrove right inside the swamp. Where do you even want to put a police post? For maybe some people that just choose to say, okay, yes, we want to be close to this place because they want to gain from criminal activities of some element. So it's not about not having presence. There has always been police presence. There has always been patrol. Even before now, except that in this country, some of us don't like to say the truth to ourselves. Ikorodu is one place that exists. Owutu, Ishawo, Igbo Olomu, Imushin, all those areas. Alakpete, what? How do I get to know? It's because I go there that I lead convoy patrol into some of those areas sometimes. So it's just a matter of people, you know, saying the truth to ourselves and, of course, volunteering to also support efforts of the security agents.
All right.
Yes, you focus, you keep on saying Arepo, Ikorodu. This thing extends. You know, you have the pipeline from Atlas Pump that takes the oil products to Musini. So it's something that stretch from that area up to Festac, Ijagemo, Ijedodo, where they've call it, and all these areas, Igodo, all these areas have boundaries with Ogun State. So it's not just
the
Arekpo area that the security is focusing attention on. Stretch to Badagry, the security is focusing attention on that. And we believe that with this decisive operation, joint operation that is going on, that the fellows, that the criminal elements too, will have a rethink and approach government to say that, yes, we want to do something meaningful.
All right, you talked about the natives earlier on, sometimes being accomplices of some of these crimes, of the militants, because they work within a certain village community. And the villagers there know these things are happening and sometimes. Now, when it comes to arrests, how will that take place? Or let me just put it blank. Has there been arrest of some of these villagers you might deem to be accomplices to these militants?
Arrests have always been made. As well, going back to what you asked last, are they being profiled? Yes, as the operation goes on, people that escaped from the 12th of operations have been arrested. Items recovered from them have been put together to match. Mind you, before now, who suffered greatly before? The security agencies. Over the past 4 or 5 years, there have always been cases where, in the course of vandalizing the pipeline, either policemen, civil defense, military officers, SSS are killed. If you take a data of that, you'll find out that actually we've even lost probably more than what we're having now. And when those things were happened, before I came to Lagos, I happened to be in force headquarters. I've been following the statistics. I've written report a bit before. The leadership of the security agencies know that. The security agents used to be the ones that suffer casualties, and some of the elements, some of the people that live there have always been the people that cover them. So arrests have always been made. There are so many cases in court that, and of course, when they go to court, some of those cases are also bailable. So if they are given bail, they come out, the thing you will hear is that, oh, yes, they were arrested and they were left. We cannot stop what the rule of law says, that, okay, yes, if you are arrested and you are even arraigned in court, you are entitled to bail. So if they're given bail, you cannot still go back and say you are arresting them. That is why you will see some of their faces
still
back in the community. And they will say, don't mind those security people. They've collected money.
All right, let's come to this joint operation that's tagged Operation Awatse. You have the civil defense, police, the military, and
the SSS.
The SSS, you know, combining forces to take out this militant. But I'm wondering, how clinical really is this operation in such a way that you don't end up, you know, taking innocent lives out of the way in the bid to, you know, protect not just the pipelines, but the people themselves?
Excellent. It's been done with professional precision. And that is why when we do this kind of operations, we run what is called a joint operation room, where when you go for a strike, you come back, debrief yourselves, what are the lessons to be learned from these ones that we've done. And of course, even the way the operation is carried out, it shows how responsible the government is. Because prior to this time, that is what government had been looking at. Let us do our homework very well. As a responsible government, responsible enforcement, to ensure that no innocent life is lost. And that is why you have, when the hair strike is done, it is not done with a view to get collateral damage. That is why ground forces are moving in, the police, the civil defense, and the military, including putting fire brigades there, including putting the emergency response team of Lagos State there, in order to make sure that innocent civilians that live in that area are not affected. Even the criminal element, you find out that it's not done to annihilate anybody there. It's just done to target have been identified to say, okay, this structure standing there is being used as headquarters. That structure standing there is the armory of these fellows. Deprive them of the use of the weapons they've illegally acquired. And of course, the ground forces now chase, pursue houses where they run to, you cordon the place, you search. And that is how professional that this exercise has been carried out. And it's been successful so far.
All right, but we know that these militants have been involved in this, and it's quite illegal, as you have said earlier on. But this operation, apart from protecting or preventing their activities, is it meant to kill the militants or to scare them away or to arrest them?
It is meant to ensure that the criminal elements in that place, in those places, are rooted out, not only rooted out, apprehended and made to face the full wrath of the law. So the rule of law is followed. The personnel that are involved have been given a rule of engagement. They've been lectured, they've been briefed. Don't cause collateral damage. Don't take the lives of anybody into your hands. You probably may have situations where operational expediency as well would necessitate that you use appropriate force to defend yourselves. Mm-hmm. You saw the example in Niger State where security agencies, military officers are killed. So where you are faced with threat that will require that you should also use appropriate force to defend yourself, you do that. But in this operation, so far so good, we've not had any case of reckless killing. It's just for us to apprehend them, deny them freedom of operation in those areas they are operating, and make sure that we investigate. We have previous cases of security personnel being killed. Some of them are already confessing. Some of the things that is recovered from them, you'll be surprised. There's a list of some of their men in different prisons. And out from what they profit from this criminal act, they do like a tithe to contribute money to go and pay for lawyers to defend the fellows.
Not funny at
all. In the prison.
Let's even look at something you just touched on now, the weaponry at the disposal of this militants and, you know, vandals and what have you. A lot has been said about the porous nature of our borders, and one would expect that it is within the purview of the police to ensure that the borders are protected in such a way that small arms and light weapons don't come in. We've heard that 70% of SALWs in West Africa, actually in Nigeria. How do you tackle this?
Do you know
this?
Why I smile?
Yes.
It was so unfortunate. Even if someone cannot sleep well, there's the police. The man that cannot sleep with his wife is the police. You have forgotten that there are security agencies that have the responsibilities of protecting the borders. Yes, we have an overall responsibility for internal security as the lead agency. You have the Nigerian Customs at the border, who are supposed to check what comes in and what goes out.
There is collaboration between the police and
police
other security forces. Like
away from that, the border, the protection of the border is solely the responsibility of some other agencies. But because no one agency can do it alone, we've been, lot of synergy. And of course, I would say that those agencies have been doing their work very well. There have been a lot of cooperation. The last major operation and one of the major successes recorded in the Lagos State Command is that foiling of robberies at Seme border, where the criminal element, the guy called TK, who actually was the kingpin at Ikorodu Creek before, who had moved from there to somewhere around First Akijagema and had planned to go and unleash terror at Seme border at Benin Republic. It was the joint collaboration of the police and the customs and other security agencies that foiled that operation. And in that operation, as you said, yes, heavy weapons. Weapons that that the police don't even use, that are supposed to be military weapons. What we call general purpose machine gun. Three were recovered from those fellows then. with dynamite and everything. It's not as if the agencies that's supposed to do the work of the police is not doing its work. But when you have a country like Nigeria, as large as we are, even in the advanced countries, why do you think that some of the countries put barriers?
Is the police spread too thin?
The police is spread as per the strength we have. It is not, it's a policing globally now. It's not even about...
Spread too thin.
The police is spread as per the strength we have. It is not, it's a policing globally now. It's not even about personnel. Whenever we talk about getting more people on the road and whatever, some of us just think that, oh, we just re-echo. There are some hackneyed language people use, police, whatever, ritual. Who actually puts that together? You deploy your police as per your situation. You look at the topography, you look at the population, you look at social and economic activities. It is not just about population now. I, sitting down here, can police the whole of this axis up to Bega Bridge if you have the right technology. It is the personnel backed with technology. It is not about physical presence.
Indeed.
And that is why we say, when you say, are we thinly spread? Where you don't have physical police structure, you have motorized patrol. You have the marine police that covers some places. And you have, once you have the motorized patrol, you have a means of communication that when that motorized patrol people are going, they can communicate with the control room. You have people that are doing covert operations.
Do you have all of this on ground?
Of course, yes.
Including intelligence, which many people actually say that that seems to be lacking a great deal when it comes to
apprehending crime. Because Nigerians don't appreciate what they have. The Nigeria police has moved on. If not for intelligence, you will not be able to target with precision those places that they are bombarding now. And of course, if not for intelligence, you wouldn't be able to arrest some kidnappers who would think they've had their field day.
Yeah,
and we
but certainly
the TK example in Semeboda as the fellow lived the creek where he lived. Precision, nautical miles by nautical miles, how he moved, how he constructed his boat, how he moved from one place to the other. It's been, you know, the intelligence people are getting that information. What are the kinds of arms and ammunition this guy was carrying? When it comes to intelligence, I will tell you, and I'm saying it emphatically, we've moved on. We can compare with anywhere. But you can't have it all. Even where they have what you will rate as first-class intelligence and technology, you will know that globally now, the level of impunity is increasing. Most policing community, even outside this country, are now rethinking their rules of engagement. You are now having in the UK policemen that will be put on machine carrying guns. On the streets of UK, you won't see policemen carrying guns. You are now having some of the advanced countries like the United States of America saying that, oh, we probably need to talk again. Before, you would not see that they are demonstrating in the United States and it turns to vandalism or they killed policemen. You won't see that they're demonstrating they throw hard objects at police. It's tomatoes and eggs they will throw. So things are, globally, things are changing. And you know, the way you engage, the way you respond are also bound to change. That is the dynamism of the society. So as criminal elements evolve in the modus, the security agencies, it's not just about Nigeria. It's just unfortunate that here, we exaggerate, we don't probably know how to say the truth to ourselves. Someone that is just pushed like this, we first say, Uri Yamio, they've killed me. And I narrated an experience that I was right at Igbo Olomu in Ikorodu. Somebody called me and said, oh, militants are killing, right from my balcony. They are going to get to my house. They will soon come and kill my people there. And I said, sir, where exactly are you? Because I picked all my calls. And the guy said, yes, in my balcony, along Ishawa Road. And I said, can you look out? And I had a reason for saying that. I said, looked out. There is a convoy of police and military on patrol with armored personnel carrier. He said, no, God, don't mind those your people. They tell lies. They will tell you nothing is happening. I can see the militants coming. And I said, okay, sir, just let me know exactly where you are. Look out. You will see a Prado vehicle with a police flag on top. That is me sitting down in that car because I'm in that convoy. And the fellow started laughing. So you can see the way we do things in this part of the world. While I was coming here, someone was calling me frantically. And I said, please send me a text, Oga. And the text he sent to me is that I was driving and your men stopped me because I was not wearing a seatbelt. Can I give the phone to somebody for you to talk to a policeman? So that is the kind of people we are. So the level of impunity is increasing. There is no reason for it. It's just that people are being callous. People don't know how to say the truth. The police had moved on.
All right. Well, we'll get back to this. Let's have understanding of other issues in here. Now, police in Ogun State have paraded five suspected cultists that have been terrorizing residents of Ogijo and its environs.
Speaking about the efforts of the command in wiping out cultists and armed robbers in the state, the police public relations officer, Abimbola Oyeyemi, said the commissioner of police, Ahmed Ilyasu, has ordered officers of the command to deal decisively with criminals in the state. He urged armed robbers and kidnappers in the state to have a change of heart or risk being caught by the law enforcement agents.
If I give mercy for my life, my life didn't look good. If I die, I don't care anybody. I don't go my own judge, I don't care anybody.
I was a member of Supremo State. I was, yes. I was, yes, I denounced with evidence, with everything. 2004. I was not involved. I'm not guilty. I was not involved.
We have an information on Tuesday that two rival court groups, they are terrorizing Ogijo and its environs. And based on that, we quickly alerted our men at Ogijo, and the DPO Ogijo led his men to calm the situation down. And in their effort, they were able to arrest five among the cultists and recover some arms and ammunition from them.
All right, even though that activity is in Ogun State, but we're talking about this because of the proximity between Ogun and Lagos State, and certainly in the areas of Ogijo, Odogunyo, Ikorodu Axis generally, you see these things filtering in generally.
Yes. That, I'm happy that you have shown that, because apparently these are fellows that coming through Imota, Odogunyo area. Because everybody talk of Ikorodu, and yes, we are not complaining. Lagos is at the center, but we have a kind of collaboration between the two commands. Part of this operation, so many are also arrested at this end, because those fellows from Ogijo, they would just come into Ikorodu, did their criminal activities, run back to Ogijo. But the most unfortunate thing is that in those days, when they talk of cultism, in tertiary institutions, but you now have bricklayers, drivers, even children forming cult groups in neighborhoods. What has gone on?
Indeed.
Value. What are parents doing in order to make sure that their children don't get engaged in this? Because there is no reason for it. And I think this operation is part of, at our end here in Lagos, the so-called cult groups, the criminal elements, they have some days they celebrate. We overcame that of July. They had a day they call 7-7. That they would say 7-7, that is 7th of July, that they were celebrating, and they must kill several persons. Today is 9th. We're lucky. Yes, maybe there may be report of pocket of clashes, especially within that Ikorodu Axis, and that is where Ogijo is coming in now. My telephone is full of SMS all throughout yesterday. to say that, oh, we've noticed some strange faces. Cultists are grouping. Mm-hmm. They had what they call 8-8, where mm-hmm. they would tell you that leadership of the group must change hands, and that is the person that can kill 8 persons that we assume the leadership.
So what
so
is the
we
police
got
doing?
The intelligence. It was yesterday now, mm-hmm. so you shouldn't be asking what is the police doing again. If we didn't do something, mm-hmm. you would have heard that 8 people had been killed in that place. So we got the intelligence report and proactiveness.
Confirm for us that a DPO was killed. Was a DPO killed or not? Because
where?
Were reports in the same 8-8
operation? No, ma. Not.
There was a report of a DPO dying at the Odogwu area.
Not in Lagos State Command. I'm the Commissioner of Police in Lagos.
Okay,
State.
Well, that's
all
why
my
I said
DPOs
you should confirm it.
Are
now.
Ill and heavy.
Okay.
None of my DPO is shot. And of course, because of the proactiveness of the police, other security agencies, we share this. Everybody had been on, had been on their foot. The military, the SSS, the civil defense, the police, because we gathered this intelligence that on the 8th of August, these fellows will come and wreak havoc. So some people even called to say, we've seen too much presence of security agencies in Kodu. That was yesterday evening. Is the because we work with intelligence, we've been proactive. We may not be perfect, but as I said, thank God it had passed. Yesterday had passed. We've not had that.
But that's not to say that the police will rest on its oars. But let's even look beyond the fact that the police is there to apprehend crime and all of that. You talk about proactiveness. Is there any kind of system in place where, you know, police can actually help in preventing crime? Whether it's through public enlightenment and all of that, so that you have situations of cultism actually reduce instead of, you know, this spike in cultism that's no longer within the institutions but now on the streets?
There are things in places to prevent crime. The police patrols are there for prevention of crimes. If you go around Lagos, you will see vehicles, machine, what we call pin down points. And that's the means of prevention of crimes. And in order to get the partnership of the community, they will tell you, go around and ask. We've been doing what we call town hall meetings. The Inspector General of Police had also said, form eminent persons group. It's in order for us to, you know, enlarge the scope of our community policing. So those are preventive things that we've been doing. There is no society that is crime-free. Nowhere in the world, even where you have everything, even where you have the multitude of policemen and multitude of gadgets, except people don't live in that area. So you cannot completely eradicate crime. And in order for our people, parents, teachers, religious leaders, traditional institutions to also know that they have a role. Because if you turn the whole of Nigeria to policemen, it will still not stop crime. Yes, that is it. So all of us are police. All of us are security agents in the different groups. What we need to do is let parents be alive to their parental responsibilities. Let the traditional institutions be alive to the need to reintroduce and make sure that those values mm-hmm. that keep us as a good country are returned. There is, it's like things have gone haywire. It's like we now have to reorientate. We have to engage the schools, and we've been doing that. I have gone to schools. I've gone to markets. It's an ongoing thing. We've been working with very good people in Lagos who are volunteers. We have what we call the voluntary policing sector. They volunteer on their own. They come out to come and join us. We have the vigilantes, we have the neighborhoods, and these are the ways we prevent. But if anybody is telling you that if you have the whole of Lagos turned to policemen, you are going to eradicate crime. No.
Speaking of Lagos, how easy or otherwise has it been for you, you know, in actually doing your job as the Commissioner of Police in Lagos? Of course, we know that Lagos has, you know, pumped in quite some funds, you know, to ensuring security. How much difference has that made, for you in delivering?
I consider myself lucky with the security agencies lucky in Lagos State, because we have good citizens of Lagos. We have a government that also know that in order to that one of the basic responsibility of government is to protect life and property, and they have been forthcoming that support. And of course, we've been deploying all the tools to that one of the basic responsibility of government is to protect life and property, and they have been forthcoming that support. And of course, we've been deploying all the tools that are made available by the state government, the governor's office direct, the Lagos State Security Trust Fund, which almost every citizen of this country, you won't believe. Some people would send in 2,000 naira. Some people would send in 1,000 naira. They are encouraged to do that because they see a government, a responsible government, utilizing what they contribute to police. That is why we've been able to have vehicles stationed at different locations. That is why we've been able to dominate the security space. And we will continue to count on the support of the very good people of Lagos.
All right.
We are not perfect, but we are going to get there.
All right, give us a picture. There are some of these operations you engage either militants or cultists or whatever, armed robbers, and police officers come down at the line of duty sometimes when some of them are killed. What kind of compensation is there for some of the officers in that kind of situation?
Every job has its own risk. Apart from the insurance thing that the Nigeria police had put in place, the Lagos State government also has a kind of compensation that immediately any of the security agencies loses any of its personnel. The governor comes out straight and says, okay, yes, give this to the family and whatever. Remember, there's no amount of money that can
replace any life.
Something like that. Mm. But so far, so good. The leadership of the police has been very responsive. And when it comes to that, all of us that are wearing the uniform know what we are entitled to. And as I said, the Lagos State government is supporting us. Mm. But every job has its own risk, even your job. But there's something
Absolutely.
I don't want to forget.
Mm.
Because when we started, I don't want you to go on that, because my time may soon elapse. You have made an assertion that police and lawyers are the ones that are encouraging land
No, robbers. It was not an assertion on our part. It was reporting on what?
The reports we hear from the people.
The
perception
people.
From the people themselves who are involved in land-related issues.
That is why I said that we don't know how to say the truth to ourselves.
Because there are sorry to cut you, Honorable Commissioner. Mm. These land grabbers have been known to go to the police, whether it's, I don't want to mention zones now, to get policemen.
Okay. I'll tell you how it works.
Yes.
One, there are some of the people that, they want to be thinking that they are wise. They know it's like one Yoruba movie, one actor. There are people who went to buy Ile Orisha, the shrine, the land they use in worshipping their whatever in that community. There are some of them, maybe because they get this money by committing crimes, that they will tell you that this is the particular land that we buy. Let them come and meet me. And of course, they have been capitalizing on the fact that 99% of cases that have to do with land have a civil nature. They're not criminal. The police will not be engaged in giving anybody possession of land. They are supposed to go to court. And of course, here too, we are not used to following processes. If you ask them, go to court and go and get ownership. They will tell you which court. That is how they resort into self-help, looking for hooligans.
Maybe because they don't have confidence in the court.
No, it's not because they don't have confidence. It's because we don't like processes. We don't like doing things the right way in some cases. And when they come to the police and we tell them, let me finish. When they come to the police and we tell them that, oh, it's civil in nature, some of them would say, oh, yes, I've come, you don't arrest. But what we are doing now is that every case at all, what we are doing now is alternate dispute resolution. If you go to any station now and take a land case, we'll call you. Because if we don't do that, a matter that is otherwise civil may turn criminal. There was an example that an old policeman told me that two brothers were fighting over land, and they went to the police and the police said, oh, it's civil in nature. If we go into it now, lawyers will go and write petition against us. Go to the court and resolve. And the two brothers went home. One of them came back and said, well, you said we should go and resolve our matter now. We've resolved and we've settled. This is the result. What was the result? The head of the other man. He has stopped his head because... So that is why I told you that things evolved. That is why we now do alternate dispute resolution. Call the parties together. Please don't foment trouble. If you foment trouble. And we've now said that with the law in Lagos State, we've now said that the criminal law is there, that anybody that has gone to any land who doesn't, you don't have title and you carry criminals there, will be prosecuting you for criminal trespass, will be prosecuting you for malicious damage. That is what we've been doing in Lagos.
Honorable.
And of course, where you see loads of policemen, the police is not the judiciary.
Yes.
People will come with a court order, a judgment of the court. I have been doing it. And some of those fellows, I can also tell you, I don't have anything to hide. They run away from the police headquarters in Lagos sometimes and go to some other places. Because if you come with a judgment to say that the court has ruled in my favor over this land, I feel I should do due diligence. I'll go to the court, I have a legal department, who will go and verify. Is there an appeal pending? Is it true that the court has issued this? Because there are so many people that are criminal minded. So they don't want to follow that process.
Okay,
they
will finally, now, Honorable Commissioner, before we let you go.
Let me ask him a yes or no question in here. Now, that's just the ideals you've given.
Yes.
In practical terms, there are some persons, some members of the police police force who may want to maybe go into, they're called to handle some of these issues. Can they call you when such kind of issues arise so that you can investigate that?
It's not just on that they've been calling me. People in Lagos,
so they
even
keep
people that are not in Lagos have been calling me.
They should keep
I've
calling me.
I've given out my number. No, it's a life of service. When you wear this uniform, it's service to humanity.
Okay.
So you have surrendered yourself to humanity that you want to serve.
All right.
So I pick my calls, I read their SMS, and I respond. The ones that are not even Lagos, a lot of people will call me from Abia, people would say on the Long Bridge, which is not Lagos State, armed robbers are there. I respond, and I'm putting myself to test and to accountability of...
It's interesting you say that before we let you go finally. Now, the issue of recruitment into the police force. I had a gentleman approach me recently and he said, he asked if I knew a judge or somebody in that area who could put pen to paper to attest for him that he can join the police force. Talk to us very briefly about what it takes to join the police force today, especially now that this government talks about an additional 10,000 to be added to the 300 or so thousand that you have now.
The process is ongoing. They've done the first level of screening. Maybe in another 2-3 weeks, an aptitude test will be carried out for those ones that have been screened to be qualified. We have 3 points of entry: recruit constable, cadet inspectors, cadet ASPs. It's because of the interjection that the government wants to make now that we are using the three avenues. You know that since we started running the police academy as a university, we're just taking people like the right jump and they go into the academy for officer cadre while the recruit constables, they also join. So in addition to having the necessary paper qualifications, you should also be qualified physically. They need to see you. Bent knees are looked at, squint eyes are looked at. That is the purpose of screening. and of course the attestation, which is to be done by someone of means in the society, either the local government chairman, the principal, head teachers of the schools you've attended, judges and whatever. That is probably why that fellow had met you. And what we've been appealing to people, because to clean the system and the police, it starts from recruitment. That when they attest, they should attest rightly.
All right, Commissioner Police Lagos State, Fatah Woshedi, thank you for spending your morning with us on TVC Breakfast.
So it was a delight having you around.
All right.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Thank you.
Now, this is where we come to the end of today's edition of TVC Breakfast. Thanks for spending your morning with us. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow is going to be another time again for us to spend mornings together discussing issues that concern you and concern Nigeria. I am Mike Okwoche.
And I am Ngozi Alebu. We look forward to having you again tomorrow.